Thanksgiving Day, November 25th, 1953. American GIs spend the holiday enforcing a police action. History will rename it the Korean War. The Truman family is enjoying their second term in residence at the White House. And in Idaho, a group of local businessmen are about to become pioneers in television. They are the Boise Valley Broadcasters. And on this day at precisely 12 noon, KBOI TV2 signed on. Good evening, everyone. I'm Marty Holtman. And for the next 30 minutes, we're going to be looking back to the early days of Channel 2.
And the first day we went on the air, which was Thanksgiving in 1953, we did a remote broadcast of a football game between Nampa and Boise High Schools, because high school was really the thing as far as football was concerned in those days.
And of course, we had no audience. We had nothing. A going station was worth about $3 million. We got on with credit and $250,000.
We had on the board Fred M. Taylor, who was a federal judge. Joe Albertson was on the board in due course of time. Bob Howell was also the film manager in the station. Myself got on the board eventually.
From the beginning, the station has been a proud member of the Columbia Broadcasting System.
I didn't decide to go with CBS. CBS decided to go with me. I was mayor, and the CBS owner in Seattle came and said, would you manage the CBS station for me? And he made an attractive offer, much more so than being mayor.
We've always had a excellent support from Boise, and I think it sailed along and continues to this day in that manner.
Prior to the station signing on, General Manager Westerman Willick dedicated himself to bringing Boise a professional television news gathering organization.
Well, that's what we had to do in order to gain a rating, because when we started here, CBS was not on top.
And, Boise Valley Broadcasters decided they were going to go into the television business. Mr. Willick got in touch with me and asked me if I'd come back and go to work with them, because I was the only one they knew at that time that had any television experience. And everything was live. We had no way of recording anything unless it was a news story, and our reporters would go out with 16-millimeter film cameras and use those for the news stories. But all the studio work was live.
And actually, we became the station that was always there. We were the first to cover city council meetings. Basically full-time. We were the first to broadcast from the legislature. There were no hookups to the networks. We got what news we got came in a 16-millimeter film reproduction that came maybe 3, sometimes 4 days after the fact. We only had a couple of people you call full-time camera people. The rest were combination people in those days that could use a camera. In fact, everybody on the news staff could use a camera. We all did it one time or another. They were reporters. They were beat men, beat people. We did everything. I think maybe while the news today is much more sophisticated, much more technical, we had more all-around type people. That's the type of person we look for. The one who could handle a camera, who could edit, who could write script, who could go on the air.
That news department at that time was the finest gathering of people that I've ever seen in a small market. And we were the news operation of this community. One of the first assignments I got was to cover a meeting of the old Boise Foundation, a group of men that actually were the forerunner of the Boise Redevelopment Agency we have today. Their basic thrust at that time was that something needed to be done downtown. Shopping needed to be revitalized, streets needed to be improved, we needed to have a rebuilt downtown. And they were looking at a rather small area, and they were looking at it in private enterprise. And there were 6 to 8 local business people, 2 or 3 of whom are still involved in the story. I was assigned to go to a meeting of the group, a particularly important meeting. I forget exactly what the topic was, but the meeting was going to be closed, and we knew that in advance. And my news director sent me over there to do it, and he said, by all means, make your protest of a closed meeting if you're put out, and, you know, see to it that they do it by the book. Well, the meeting was closed, and I was escorted out. The man who closed the meeting and ordered me out was H. Westerman Willock, who was signing my paycheck at Boise Valley Broadcasters. And the man who assigned me to go cover the thing and get myself in that position was Dick Eardley.
I would take a black crayon and go in about 15, no, maybe a half hour before airtime and mark the board. The high pressure systems, the low pressure systems. I really had to study when I started the weather, and I did. I went to the library and I went out to the Weather Bureau and I interviewed those fellows, and they were so kind to me. And it's a study and it's fascinating.
But I feel very fortunate that I had the reputation that I had and the acceptance that I had among the viewers of Channel 2. And yeah, it was one of the appellations that somebody put on me. I was the Walter Cronkite of the Boise Valley. That was a great, great compliment, I'll tell you, of course, because Cronkite has always been such a magnificent news personality that to be mentioned in the same breath with Walter Cronkite was quite a compliment.
Oh, I had the opportunity during my 15 years at KBOI, KBOI in those days, to have met and covered President Kennedy, President Johnson, former President Truman when he was out. Most of the big ones came through at one time or another. The Kennedy story we caught when he made a quick stop in Boise during his campaign.
In Dallas, Texas, three shots were fired at President Kennedy's motorcade in downtown Dallas.
I remember standing back by the teletypes in the newsroom when they started banging, and I don't know the situation today. I haven't been around the newsroom that much, but in those days you had so many bells for a flash and so many bells for a bulletin. It had to be big to get the bells ringing on either AP or UPI. They started ringing and we went in and saw where he'd been shot. CBS and the other networks immediately picked up basically live coverage, but I was still standing in front of the teletype when the word came that he had died. And utter shock, utter total shock at the time, wondering what the world's coming to. And after shedding our tears and at least trying to get through the shock period, we went out and did the stories, the best local tie-ins, putting together some film footage that we had of the president and other things, film footage of when he was here. The things that you have to do in the news business. Those are the things you remember. The days when Bob Smiley was in his three terms as governor of this state. Not an outstanding governor. I think history will show he was one of the best the state has had. To the issues he pushed that brought this state into modern times. Tonight, oh, there was a strong minority who felt one way, and maybe another minority that very much opposite, feeling gung-ho for the war, and a large group in between that were just very ambivalent about it. This despite the fact that Senator Frank Church was one of the leading opponents of that war. Those type of people that you're exposed to, being able to watch history unfold, so to speak, over 15 years, and I think when you look back, those 15 years might be as big as any 15, 20-year period in the history of the state, with only one or two exceptions. It was fun to be a part of it. It's nice to look back on now.
It was kind of a teamwork type thing, which was really what you strive for, I think, in a newscast. And it was pretty loose. We used to do things. I remember I did my sports one night in a balloon, a blue balloon that Marler was holding. And then when my sports was over, he just...
And the set, news set, used to be on that turntable. And Bill Gratton used to sit out way in front of it, and it would shoot over his shoulders. They would introduce sports and weather, and that thing would turn and introduce them. And we had just gotten done with sports and came back to Bill, and Bill says, and now with the stock market report brought to you by whoever it was at that time, Wayne Davis. And the set turned around, and there was Wayne's coat hanging on a little nail on the set. And Wayne had fallen asleep in the prop room. One night during a Dialing for Dollars movie, we had some people out back throwing a football.
We hit the power lines with a football, and two wires blew out a transformer.
And I won't mention their names at this point.
Bang, everything went dark.
And it looked like the 4th of July as the transformers and the various things went.
She was right off the air for that night.
The station's dedication to news has on occasion gone beyond just reporting.
The murder of a child and his mother in Mountain Home, and the arrest of an airman at Mountain Home Air Force Base, and he was charged with the murder. And
the evidence was very strong that the man, member of the armed forces from the Mountain Home Air Force Base, was placed at the scene of the murder. The question was whether or not he murdered the young lady. The law enforcement people that were there felt they had an open and shut case because his identification was established, and the fact of him being with the corpse was clearly proven beyond any reasonable doubt.
Kept me up for long hours. They tried to scare me into it. They said, if you don't confess, says that if you fight it, you go to the gas chamber.
Some 2 or 3 months later, we had an escapee. Well, we had a murder of a child in Boise. And it turned out, they found out quickly, it was done by a fellow who'd walked away from the Ada County Jail. Had a call from the, I couldn't tell you now whether it was the police department or the prosecutor's office or whatever. And they wanted to do a recreation of the incident the night before when the child had been killed. A couple of days later, I had asked Rick to do a story on how did this guy walk away from the Ada County Jail and wind up killing the child? How did he get out of jail? We were doing a special report on that. Rick was in there, and during his filming, he was filming in the jail area, and he said he wanted to talk with him. He had recognized the KBOI blazer, and so Rick was allowed in the cell and sat down and talked with him, and over a course of about an hour, he confessed to the murders in Mountain Home. Raphael was enough of a reporter to drag out all of the information, down to the fact that, and some of the things had never been released by the police, that the knife used in Mountain Home had a hooked edge on it, either broken edge or it was hooked in some way. The murder weapon had never been found. Some other things stolen from the house that night had never been found. And
after our reporter, Rick Raphael, had discussed this with the other occupant of the jail, who admitted that he had done it, it was obvious that the crime had been committed before this young man had come on the scene, so that the identity and the identification was proper. It turned out to be that he had not committed the crime.
And you said that he threatened to prosecute your wife. Did they tell you at any time that they had arrested her?
No. No, they said, he says that, you know, he says that your wife told us that you told her you did it.
And they actually told you?
Yes, sir, they told me that. And they said, you know, your wife wants to tell on you, but she don't want to be a squealer. They said, come on, cop a plea. I was mixed up. I was confused. I was fighting, but I couldn't.
Who was? You're all alone.
I was all alone. That was right.
We put the story together, checked it very quickly with station lawyers, called the prosecutor locally, called the prosecutor in Mountain Home, called the sheriff's office, called the defense attorney in Mountain Home.
And once the authorities were convinced of that by forensic evidence, it was established and they were satisfied and the man was released.
We had the jump on that story because of a lot of connections we'd had before, things we'd done, and we had more than anybody else. We fed it to the networks and fed it to everybody else.
What's your feeling as far as the American court system right now?
Right now, I think it's wonderful. But if you asked me that about a month ago, I'd say I can understand why she's got that blindfold on.
Well, as things happen in prison, it didn't do him any good to get his formal education there. And there was a fellow who had committed murder and rape in the Boise area that was also a one of the real rough homosexuals at the prison, and he had assaulted a few guys at the prison, and so they decided what they were going to do is they were going to get this guy. And so they convinced Bill what he should do is he should stand by a doorway, and they were going to light a fire near where this guy was. The guy was going to run through the door, and Bill was going to nail him, and they were going to beat him up. So all that occurred, and the guy ran through the door, and Bill, who was really big, he nails the guy, knocks him down, and this other inmate whips out a knife and just kills the guy. Bill turned state's evidence against this guy, and they say fine, and the guy gets an additional sentence tacked on to whatever he was in for, and they ship him out of state because you don't want these two guys to be in the same cell. Well, about 3 years later, what happens is that Montana, I believe it was, says, we can't handle this guy anymore. He's coming back to Idaho. And Bill says, when he hears about it, he says, is this true? And the prison staff said, oh, yeah, it's true, but don't worry about it. We can keep him away from you, and there'll be no problems. And Bill says, whoa, 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 whoa. You know, this is not good. He gets in the truck as they're heading out to do some detail, and he leaves.
This fellow indicated that he would turn himself in, but he would only turn himself in to Larry. Apparently, he had befriended him, and had Larry had been very honest with him. And as a result, he was willing to turn himself in, providing that Larry would accept him and see that he had safe passage to the authorities.
So one of my neighbors was Wayne Kidwell, who was the Attorney General of the state of Idaho. So I went over to Wayne's home and said, Wayne, here we've got an inmate from the Idaho State Penitentiary who's willing to give himself up. He says, well, I can't guarantee you that the guy will get everything. He says, but I can just about guarantee you. I'm sure we can do something if he'll give himself up. So we had Tim Storrs and a photographer down at the courthouse with Wayne Kidwell. And car stops. It's one of the county's deputy. I remember him saying something like, God, that guy looks familiar. I said, well, you know, that's because you guys have been chasing him for 2 weeks.
The inmates wanted media representatives to go inside, pick up a list of grievances they had, and to talk to the two guard hostages that they had. We were chosen by the inmates, and so reporter Bob Loy and I went inside, and we were the only ones to get inside. We were guided in by a group of friendly inmates, and they took us to cell house 9, where the most of the activity was going on, and that's where the hostages were being held.
Our job was to transmit a list of grievances to corrections officials, items which the Citizens Committee was to investigate.
As Bob Loy and I walked inside the gates, and we were surrounded by this group of inmates that were protecting us as we went inside, I fired up the recorder and the camera, and the recorder died. It died. Took a tape and chomped it inside. I leaned over to Bob and I said, we've got a little problem here. And he goes, oh no, what, they're gonna kill us. I said, they're gonna kill us if you keep talking.
As we had already seen, July 23rd was to be a day of surprises. But we found in that hot, smoky cell block did nothing to alter that. Despite statements from corrections officials to the contrary, Leonard Orr was not the only hostage. Corrections Officer Calvin May from A House had just been captured.
Well, I knew there was a story to be had, and a good story to be had inside. Everybody else was getting the standard stuff outside the fence. I wanted to be inside. That's where things were happening. And that's why we needed to get inside, and we did. I was a lot younger and a lot more naive then. I didn't know what kind of danger I was really in. And it really didn't hit me until a couple of weeks later when I had out to the prison, and some friendly inmates had told us that we had no idea how much danger we were really in. We were trying to produce not only our news stories from the footage, but a half-hour documentary from the footage, and then plus supplying all the networks and international news agencies with the footage that they needed. So it was a pretty hectic time. We also had the prosecutor knocking on our door.
Well, that was the start, of course, of a series of procedures that were filed in court by the county prosecutor's office with the assistance of the Attorney General's office in attempting to have us turn over our material to the law enforcement people. We felt at that time that we owed an obligation to preserve the evidence.
We do not give out work material. We simply don't. That's our property. The prosecutor asked to see the material. We agreed they could see the material, but they wanted to take the material away from our workplace. We won't allow that. We were not about to allow that.
I must say we weren't terribly cooperative at that time. As I recall, it was a Saturday morning when they stormed our offices with all types of writs,
yes, I will.
Seeking the possession of the tape.
And they came pounding on our doors one day, and they came in and took our material.
723-80 and 724-80. Certain buildings, the KBCI television headquarters building, located at 1007 West Jefferson. The search warrant is a court order for us to take custody of these films.
As news director of this television station, I feel this is a clear infringement of our First Amendment rights. Seeing we have no legal recourse, I suppose you can search.
So it was a long, drawn-out court battle, and it went on for better than over a year, as I recall. Made all kinds of international news. It was I'd like to say it was a precedent-setting case, but it really wasn't. It got a lot of attention. We didn't win. We put up a hell of a good fight. But it will certainly make prosecutors and others think twice about the methods that they use next time to obtain material.
And you know something? The station has always been well-respected for the caliber of its local programs.
People thought that we had it rigged.
Good point.
No, I'm serious.
Good point.
Because these guys were so good.
When the mail would come in, you would keep the mail. You were the sole possessor of
that. You guys never saw it. You didn't know what I had.
And he knew the format of the program that we would do anywhere from 12 to 18 or 20 pieces of mail and each week. And Billy is a good musician. And he knew that we, like he said, it was not geared. We couldn't get them all, it wouldn't be a good program. And we couldn't lose them all, or it wouldn't be a good program. So Bill knew the tunes that we would probably know.
But they never knew what I was going to throw at them until I threw it at them.
Sometimes we'd lose a lot more candy than we were supposed to.
Yeah, that's right.
And sometimes we'd get more tunes than was good for the show, too.
That's right.
For instance, if Bill would say, here's a letter from Mrs. So-and-so, and she wants to know if you know Moonlight and Roses. And he might start playing Stars and Stripes Forever.
Yeah.
And Billy'd say, no, that's not
it. No.
And we'd all chime in and play with him and override him. And he'd have a heck of a time getting us started, or stopped, and sometimes getting us started, too.
Yeah, true.
There was a lot of horseplay. If there wasn't, there wouldn't have been any interest in the program, you know.
And I was supposed to fill in for a few days until they got a professional. So I kept waiting. It wasn't because I was so good, but I was so cheap. $125 a month is what I was paid. So I kept doing it, and it was fun. The people I met, you know, were fun. But what a nerve-wracking thing. Cameras wouldn't work, and people didn't show up, and microphones failed. And my day in the morning was to read the paper, find out who was coming to town, and then which organization was sponsoring them. Then I would call the organization and see if we could give them free time. Of course, we didn't pay anyone. If we'd give them some free advertising, if they would come down to the studio on such and such a day, and then I could interview them so I'd have a good show. And that usually worked out pretty well, unless they decided they didn't want to come, and then they just wouldn't show up. But then it was putting on the show, and then at night I would answer the mail, so it was a full-time job. I think the only time my husband watched the show was the day the bear chewed my leg, and the boys on the in the studio thought that was a good shot, so they kept just giving him a shot of this bear chewing on my leg. And that night I said, oh, my leg is killing me. He said, well, let me tell you a bedtime story. Once upon a time, there were three little bears. And I had a black and blue leg for about a month after that.
If the 60s gave birth to the Beatles, it also gave birth to this happy spook that ruled supreme on Thursday nights throughout southern Idaho in the mid-60s. He hosted a popular series of spook movies on a program known as The Unknown. His name, my alter ego at that time,
Claude Gloom.
We had a space theme for a number of years here at Channel 2. It was an hour and a half live program every day from 3:30 until 5. We had cartoons, and we used to have this studio, this very studio, filled with kids every afternoon. My character was Sky West. It was always a space theme. We'd have a rocket ship, and we'd land that every afternoon at 3:30 and run cartoons and have interviews with the kids and contests and promotions and generally a lot of fun every afternoon.
In the early 80s, economic conditions and increased competition resulted in a lessening of overall station dominance and market share.
A group of factors that affected the station. One of them was the expansion, the performance of the networks. ABC entered the picture actually earlier than the 70s, but they grew, matured, and eroded the viewing that the station had achieved. CBS had been numero uno, and still is as far as network goes nationwide. They've lost to NBC in the most recent years, but I think out of the last 30 years, they held it for 25 to 26 years. But increased level of competition, cable became a factor as far as bringing in imported signals into the market. In the early 80s, there was an independent that signed on that made a significant impact to the market. And just the changing appetites of our clientele. But I don't think the goals have changed over the last 30 years. I think the competition might have changed, but how you make a good business run is a basic formula, and that's supplying a good product in a timely fashion, doing what you say you're going to do, innovate, try new things, continue to grow, always keeping yourself and your people challenged, and hopefully doing a better job than your competition. All of these factors have been evident in business since its inception.
Channel 2 is extremely proud of its 33 years of service to the Treasure Valley. The station wishes to thank you, the viewers, and the dedicated broadcast pioneers whose effort have given Channel 2 such a proud past. Thank you, and good night.
I listened to before. I swear you've taught me everything I know. Can't imagine needing someone so. But through the years it seems to me I need you more and more. Through the years, through all the good and bad, I know how much we had. I've always been so glad to be with you. Through the years, it's better every day. You've kissed my tears away. As long as it's okay, I'll stay with you through the years. Through the years when everything went wrong, together we were strong. I know. Stay.